Hachette Audio presents A Brief History of the Mediterranean by Jeremy Black, read by Roger Davis. Preface. The grand object of travelling is to see the shores of the Mediterranean. Samuel Johnson, 1776. A leading stage for world history, the Mediterranean today is the centre of the tourist experience for many, and notably so for Europeans. With tens of millions of tourists, international and domestic, every year, the sea and its shores record shifts in the sources, interests, and concerns of tourists. However, alongside these shifts, there is the central focus on the Mediterranean Sea itself, whether cruising the deep blue sea, lounging on the beaches, or visiting the port cities. The sun-blazing Mediterranean repeatedly draws the eyes of those on shore. This history will provide an account in which the experience of travel is foremost. Travel for tourism, for trade, for war, for migration, for culture, or, as often, for a variety of reasons. Linked to this, travellers had a variety of goals and situations, from rulers to slaves, merchants to pirates. We will go from the Phoenicians, travelling for trade, to the modern tourist, sailing for pleasure and cruising in ease. Throughout, the emphasis will be on the sea, on coastal regions, on port cities visited by cruise liners, such as Athens, Barcelona, Naples and Palermo, and on their connections. This is not a history of the states on the shores of the sea, the centres of which are often far distant. France is run from Paris, not Marseille, and Spain from Madrid, not Barcelona, while Turkey is governed now from Ankara and not Istanbul, earlier Byzantium, and then until the 1920s, Constantinople. Of course, the history of a sea and its shores looks beyond, and notably to the other waters that flow into it, in this case the Black Sea, the Atlantic, the Red Sea over a narrow isthmus now crossed by the Suez Canal, and rivers, from the Ebro and the Rhone to the Nile. Yet the wider significance of the Mediterranean does not mean that we should be writing a history of the world. Listeners know that Rome and Byzantium stroke Constantinople stroke Istanbul were the centres of major empires and of Christianity. They do not expect their history. We focus here instead on the sea and its shores. That, however, does not mean a lack of engagement with the wider world, for much of Western Europe and Northern Africa played a role, directly or indirectly, in the fate of the Mediterranean. At times that can make the history of the latter an account of conflict after conflict, but it is necessary to understand these wars in order to grasp the changing boundaries of the Mediterranean states, societies and religions, the buildings that have been left, and the people's culture, sense of identity and history. Chapter 1. Sea and Shores. Thy shores are empires changed in all save thee. Assyria, Greece, Rome, Carthage, what are they? Lord Byron, Childe Harold's Pilgrimage, 1812. The Atlantic waters breaking over the landlip at the western end of the Mediterranean, the most vivid episode in its history, occurred before humans left records. For long earlier, the Mediterranean, the creation of the separation of Eurasia from Africa, was a shrinking, enclosed sea, with the land joining Spain to Morocco cutting it off from the Atlantic, while there was another similar barrier from the Black Sea, rather like that which survives between the Mediterranean and the Red Sea. The limited amount of water flowing into the sea from rivers ensured that the water lost to evaporation was not replaced, and the lake became increasingly saline, leaving salt deposits that were subsequently to be important. As a result, the basin emptied, and the Mediterranean largely dried up, in what has been termed the Messinian salinity crisis, which began about 6 million years ago. However, the raising of sea levels, combined with geological stresses, transformed the situation. The land barriers that separated the Mediterranean from the Atlantic and the Black Sea were breached. The former breach, the Zanclean or Pliocene flood, probably initially began with water coming over the lip of rock in the Strait of Gibraltar as a waterfall, bringing 100 times more water per second than that at Lake Victoria, before this lip was broken about 5.3 million years ago. First in the western Mediterranean, and then, after the Sicily Sill had been breached, in the eastern, the sea rapidly filled with the ocean's water, possibly in a decade. In the case of the Black Sea, there is the suggestion that Mediterranean seawater broke into the Black Sea, then a freshwater lake, about 7200 BCE. Other explanations suggest changes for different reasons, variously in 17,000 to 14,000 BCE or 11,000 to 8,000 BCE. Certainly, the Black Sea has had a complex relationship with the Mediterranean, and the evidence for a traumatic flooding of the former is problematic. This filling created a new system of flows and currents. Water evaporated in the Mediterranean, and the failure to replace it by rainfall and rivers meant that there is a flow in from the Black Sea, and far more, from the Atlantic. Shakespeare made reference to the former, drawing on the argument in Pliny the Elder's Natural History that, fed by the rivers that flow into it, notably the Danube, the Dniester and the Don, the waters of the Black Sea, the Pontic Sea, always flow into the Sea of Marmara, the Propontic and the Dardanelles, the Hellespont, but never ebb back again. In Othello, when Iago tells the Moor that his mind may change, Othello replies, "Never, Iago, like to the Pontic Sea, whose icy current and compulsive course ne'er keeps retiring ebb, but keeps due on to the Propontic and the Hellespont, even so my bloody thoughts." This speech reflected the lasting knowledge of Mediterranean geography that stemmed from the writings of the Classical Age, and especially once these works were printed in the Renaissance. The flow of water in from the Atlantic is even greater because the saltier and heavier Mediterranean water flows out under the incoming Atlantic waters, thereby not creating resistance to the eastward flow from the ocean. This creates a navigational problem for ships trying to row or sail west, although this problem was in part circumvented by ships using an undertow along the northern shore that enabled them to move west. This expedient was employed by the Phoenicians and enabled them to establish a base to the west of the Strait of Gibraltar at Cadiz. The pattern of Mediterranean currents is at once simple, yet also complex. The former is explained by the major current moving in a counterclockwise direction, eastwards along the coast of North Africa, then from south to north past Israel and Lebanon, before moving back westwards along the northern shores of the Mediterranean back to the Strait of Gibraltar. Yet complex because the Mediterranean is in part a product of subsidiary seas, from east to west the Aegean, Adriatic and Tyrrhenian, and there is significant disruption to currents and weather produced by major islands, such as Cyprus and Sicily. These islands are the product of a varied subsea geology that includes flatter areas, notably the Cyprus and Ionian basins, and the Balearic Plain, as well as the opposite, particularly the Mediterranean Ridge. The combination of these with changing sea levels ensured past periods in which modern islands, for example, Euboea and Sicily, were joined to the continental landmass, in their cases Greece and Italy, while some were joined to other islands, as with Minorca and Majorca, or Corsica and Sardinia. On islands, animals living in isolation developed particular characteristics, becoming smaller or larger. Crete had a small dog-sized elephant and still has distinctive goats, while Italy's Gargano Peninsula, when an island, had giant hedgehogs, owls and dormice. The melting of the ice sheets at and after the end of the ice ages affected sea levels, but far more than varying sea levels were involved in the changing physical history of the Mediterranean. In the shadow of the risk of volcanic eruptions and earthquakes, the Mediterranean had a precarious and volatile existence. There have been major earthquakes and volcanic activity in historic times, as in the major eruption on the Aegean island of Santorini in about 1645 to 1500 BCE, the earthquake that wrecked the Italian city of Amalfi in 1343 CE, sending much of it into the sea, that in 1384 which killed the Duke and Duchess of Lesbos, the earthquakes in Calabria in 1793, Crete in 1810, Basilicata in Italy in 1857, the island of Chios in 1881, the western Peloponnese in 1886, Calabria in 1905, Messina in 1908, Izmir in 1928, Greece in 1932, Algeria in 1980, destroying 25,000 houses, and the 1980 earthquake that greatly damaged Salerno's Norman Cathedral. Conspiracy theorists continue to argue that earthquakes or volcanoes are caused by hostile forces, although by 2017 this took the shape in Turkey of claims that American and Israeli seismic ships were intentionally setting off earthquakes. The continuing nature of this precarious existence is abundantly clear, most obviously in the shadow of Vesuvius on the Bay of Naples and again near Etna, both mighty volcanoes. The relationship between the Eurasian and African tectonic plates, one that will probably bring the Mediterranean to an end in about 50 million years as the African plate continues to move north, is linked to continuing volcanic activity. This is really apparent at Mount Etna in Sicily, which is very active, and where an eruption in 2014 forced the temporary closure of Catania Airport. For tourists past and present, visits to volcanic sites, notably Vesuvius, Etna and Santorini, were and remain a key part of the Mediterranean itinerary. On cruises, passing Stromboli, the lighthouse on the Mediterranean, in the Aeolian Islands, north of Sicily, at night, and seeing it lit up by volcanic activity is truly dramatic. The volcano there erupted in 2002, and again in July 2019, when the island was covered in ash and a hiker killed, while scores of tourists fled from beaches into the sea. Nearby, Vulcano is quieter, though it has smoke, smells and sulfates, and the grand crater can be climbed. Obsidian, produced by volcanic activity, has a hard and glass-like quality, can be fractured to produce sharp blades, and was an important working material for early human society. The islands of Lipari, Pantelleria, and Milos had major deposits of obsidian, and these encouraged trade. The past explanation of islands included an awareness of geological change. Strabo, a wide-ranging Greek geographer, around 63 BCE to around 23 CE, in his Geography, 7 BCE, referred to Sicily as rent from the continent by earthquakes. The fire that was smouldering beneath the earth, together with the wind, produced violent earthquakes because the passages to the surface were all blocked up, and the regions thus heaved up yielded at last to the force of the blasts of wind, were rent asunder, and then received the sea. It is more plausible that the islands in the high seas were heaved up from the deeps, whereas it is more reasonable to think that those lying off the promontories and separated merely by a strait from the mainland have been rent therefrom. Very differently, Strabo commented on what we would see as a tsunami near Tyre in Lebanon. A wave from the sea, like a flood tide. The ebb uncovered the shore again and disclosed the bodies of men lying promiscuously among dead fish. Like occurrences take place in the neighbourhood of the Mount Cassius, situated near Egypt, where the land undergoes a single quick convulsion and makes a sudden change to a higher or lower level, the result being that whereas the elevated part repels the sea and the sunken part receives it, yet the land makes a reverse change and the site resumes its old position. A tsunami of up to 30 metres or 98 feet was produced by a large earthquake at the island of Amorgos in the Cyclades archipelago in the Aegean Sea in 1956. Alongside currents came the pattern of the winds, which changed very greatly by season and in response to weather systems. Thus, summer winds in the eastern Mediterranean tend to come from the northwest. Winds such as the Mistral, a southerly that blows onto the coast of Provence, made being able to take shelter in harbours very important. Before observing that, along most of its coast, Italy, is harbourless, Strabo focused on those sites that provided good protection from the waves, such as Brindisi, a key harbour on the route across the southern Adriatic to Greece, where the land, shaped like stag's horns, offered safe anchorage, whereas nearby Taranto, because of its wide expanse, is not wholly sheltered from the waves, and there were also shallows in the inner harbour. His accuracy was high. Issues for the traveller were far more challenging in the technology of the past. Galleys had a low freeboard and therefore were vulnerable to high waters in poor weather. As a result, autumn and winter weather were particular challenges. For example, the Turks allegedly lost 60 ships in a storm in late 1538. But in practice, the entire year could be challenging, not least in terms of going aground. In May 1698, Robert Clayton, a British tourist, planned to sail from Naples to Sicily. We had hired for this voyage a felucca with 8 straight oars, and the 16th in the morning we had a very clear sky and a perfect calm. Everything seemed to smile and tempt us to the voyage, and promised a safe and quick passage to Messina. Accordingly, about 9 in the morning we put to sea. We rowed directly over the gulf for the Isle of Capri, and we were about 20 miles from Naples. We felt a small breeze of wind, the sea began to swell, upon which our pilot steered directly to Massa, a town near the point of the promontory and the nearest land we could make to. We had not rowed an hour, but the sky grew cloudy, and it blew very hard, and the sea ran so high against us that we rather retired to Naples than advanced to Massa, and at last our oars became useless, which obliged us to put up our sail and endeavour to gain Capri, and so we beat for near an hour, against the wind and sea both increasing still. Our vessel lay so much on one side that near a yard of the sail was continually under water, whilst the sea ran over the other side of the boat, and every wave seemed to threaten destruction. We are still 6 miles from Capri, and found that we advanced but very little, and that with great danger, and at last found no other security but to return before the wind to Naples. The weather continues still blustering. I shall lay aside all other points of pursuing this voyage. Yet unpredictability could play to the advantage of the tourist. Writing from Sicily in April 1792, Thomas Brand, a bear leader or travelling tutor, noted that, with his charge Charles Lord Bruce, he had a most prosperous sail of 4 nights and 3 days and a half cross Hesperian seas from Naples to Palermo. It was nearly a perfect calm. Indeed, it was much fitter for the revels of Aphrodite and her maids of honour than for any mortal expedition. The Sicilian packets are the most convenient things you can imagine. Each passenger has his cabin. They have a good dining room, and the captains of both of them have had an English marine education. However, subsequently that April, Brand was delayed at Messina because the wind is very contrary. Our original intention was to have returned to Palermo and have taken the packet there, but we are sick of Sicilian roads and accommodations, and as the north side of the triangle contains nothing worth seeing, we determined to take the opportunity of a Neapolitan brig, a boat of good character, and hope to be at Naples nearly as soon as this letter. As part of a world we have lost, Brand's use of classical comparisons was commonplace for the period and across the arts. So were the references to storms in the Mediterranean. Indeed, Homer's Iliad and Odyssey played a significant role in elite cultural consciousness. It leaves its influence clearly in Idomeneo, 1781, Mozart's classical opera, one set in Crete on the return of the Greeks from the Trojan War. A harsh sea god, Neptune, terrible storms over a deadly sea, and a sea monster are all part of the action. Idomeneus was a figure in Homer's Iliad. The Mediterranean was certainly not solely the calm sea background to the painting of ports and coastal scenes bathed in light by, for example, the French artist Claude Lorraine in the 17th century and his British counterpart Richard Wilson in the 18th. The Shipwreck Museum at Kyrenia in North Cyprus, which exhibits the remains of a Greek merchantman of the 4th century BCE, provides an instructive view that can be amplified by the archaeological museum at Lipari in the Aeolian Islands, which contains well-displayed shipwrecked cargoes from antiquity. There can still be storms today. Vulnerability to the wind was a continual fear. It is not surprising that churches represented or contained thanks for survival. Allegedly, the cathedral at Cefalù in Sicily, founded in 1131 by Roger II of Sicily, commemorated his finding refuge from a savage storm at the port. Similarly, the sanctuary of Bonaria near Cagliari on Sardinia was constructed by the Aragonese in 1325. And contains the image of Our Lady of Bonaria, which reflected the impact of a 1370 storm on a Spanish merchantman en route to Italy. An image of the Virgin Mary did not sink, but came ashore. As with many of the coastal temples of antiquity, the image became a lodestar of protection to sailors, and was honoured accordingly. The Cathedral Museum in Cagliari holds a collection of items seized from Pope Clement VII during the sack of Rome in 1527 by rampaging unpaid mercenaries. The Catalan sailors who had them were engulfed in a savage storm, and in thanks for their survival, handed them over to the Archbishop. The theme of safe voyages went on being significant, as in the marble murals of the mid-19th century Notre-Dame de la Garde Basilica in Marseille. Problems certainly hit individual travellers. In January 1760, Edward Tucker, who had come the previous year by sea from England to Genoa, nearly being captured by a French ship off Corsica, this was during the Seven Years' War of 1756 to 1763, intended to spend only 4 or 5 days in Leghorn or Livorno. By the feluccas, which, weather permitting, constantly pass and repass betwixt this and Leghorn every day, and for this month past have been in daily expectation of setting out for this place, but continual rain and hard gales of wind always rendered it impracticable for a felucca to put to sea, till this I am now arrived in. In 1785, Charles Sloane had a quicker passage from Sicily to Malta, but we got over in 12 hours and had a storm astern most of the way. I was dead sick, and had I not been so, should have been greatly alarmed for my safety, as we were in a boat which 6 rowers called a Sparonara. Naval operations were much affected by the weather in the age of galley and sail. Fleets badly damaged in storms included the Persian fleet, wrecked in the Aegean in a storm off Mount Athos in 492 BCE, that returning from the 8th Crusade in 1270, which was hit off Trapani in Sicily, and Charles V's fleet off Algiers in 1541. The destructiveness of the last storm led to the end of the expedition. In September 1800, Vice Admiral William Young of the British Royal Navy wrote to his wife from Tetuan Bay in Morocco, "We may truly be considered as a wandering army at the mercy of the winds and waves, for we left Gibraltar merely on account of the anchorage there being unsafe for a large fleet, in case of a westerly gale, and if we should meet with a levant or easterly wind here, we must then weigh from this, and push out of the straits." Shipboard life was generally difficult. In December 1801, John Hill of the Royal Welsh Fusiliers, who had served with the British Army in Egypt, wrote to his mother from Gibraltar, "On shipboard, private soldiers suffer oftentimes as much almost as before an enemy. The accommodation was crowded and insanitary, and there was constant exposure to the weather and fear of sinking or falling overboard. Few could swim. Even if no storms were encountered, voyages could still be inconvenient. A British tourist who set off in September 1778 from Genoa for Livorno recorded, "Not being sure of the wind the next morning, and having passed a disagreeable, uncomfortable night in the chaise, the carriage, which took up too much of the vessel that there was no room to stir two steps, we turned up the Gulf of La Spezia and landed at Lerici. Putting the carriage on board in order both to ship it and to provide accommodation was normal. The need to sail was not only a matter of voyages in which it was necessary to cross the sea, as to the islands in the sea or between North Africa and Southern Europe. There were also the problems posed by the inaccessible nature of much of the coastline, the absence of roads along many shorelines, and linked to this, but also separate, the relative advantage arising from the greater directness, cargo-carrying capacity, and speed that were possible by sea. As well as having few anchorages, the long, largely mountainous coast of Morocco and Algeria was particularly bad for road links, but it was not alone in this. On the European shore of the Mediterranean, the roads were especially bad on the Albanian, Dalmatian, Calabrian, and Sardinian shores, for example, that of eastern Sardinia, but not only there. In particular, there was no practical route along the Mediterranean coast between Marseille and Genoa until the 19th century, in part due to an absence of good roads in the county of Nice, which was part of the dominions of Savoy-Piedmont. An anonymous British tourist crossed the River Var between Antibes and Nice in 1754, but not without taking guides with us, who were always ready to wade through, find out the best fords for your chair, and support it, if there should be occasion. The sands move frequently, which makes the bottom extremely dangerous. In 1776 to 1777, another anonymous British tourist noted, "These torrent courses are the roads, and in some parts, the only roads of the country. A road has been formed from Nice over Montalban to Villafranche, just practicable for a carriage, but so steep and so rough that it is scarcely safe, and a carriage is very seldom seen on it. The road to Monaco is practicable only for mules, asses, or mountain horses, and in some parts is scarcely safe with any of them." This road was so bad that he got off his mule and went by foot. East of Monaco, the Ligurian mountains fell sheer to the sea, and it was not practicable to go by land to Genoa. The Grande Corniche road on the Riviera between Nice and Menton was not opened until Napoleon's time. Its construction reflected his political and strategic interest in better communications between France and Italy, and his control over the latter, one that was greater than that of any previous French ruler, even Charlemagne. Both men were crowned King of Italy in what proved high points in France's long-standing interest in Italy, one that was longer and greater than that of Spain. To get between France and Italy, travellers had to choose between the Alps via the Mont Cenis Pass and the Mediterranean. Both were hazardous and uncomfortable routes, and each was greatly affected by the weather. The feluccas, the local boats, were small, vulnerable to storms, and dependent on the wind. In 1723, John Molesworth observed, "No mariners in the world are so cowardly as the Italians in general, but especially the Genoese, so that upon the least appearance of a rough sea they run into the first creek, when their feluccas are sometimes wind-bound for a month." In 1734, Andrew Mitchell was "detained some weeks longer in Genoa than I intended, and that by bad weather, for if it blows the least, or if there is anything of a sea, the feluccas won't go out." On the 1st of November he sailed to Savona, but the next contrary wind obliged him to put into Luano and to have the felucca hauled ashore, as there was no harbour. "I was detained here a whole day by the laziness of the Italian sailors, who chose rather to lie in the port and take their chance for a wind afterwards than to put to sea in fair weather, If there is the least swell in the sea, they will by no means venture out. The situation did not improve until the age of steam. Indeed, the continued problems of sea travel contrasted with the gradual improvement in overland journeys as roads were constructed or improved. Travellers could cope with discomfort. Instead, it was the uncertainty that storms, contrary winds and calms brought to timetables that was the crucial problem. None was to be overcome until the 19th century, when steamships developed and became effective and reliable. Sailing from Marseille to Civitavecchia in 1778, Philippa, Lady Knight, an impecunious widow travelling with her daughter Cornelia, observed, "Our voyage was somewhat tedious, as we were, after 7 weeks waiting for a wind, 30 days on our passage, putting into different ports." Lady Elizabeth Craven was so fed up in September 1785 that she cut short her passage from Genoa to Livorno and instead landed in Viareggio in order to continue her journey by land. There was also the question of the boat itself. Responses varied. John Holroyd had a pleasant journey from Genoa to Livorno in 1764. Efeluca is a large sort of open boat which makes use of sails and oars. There was an awning to protect us from the sun, and I had a good bench for a bed during the night. The expedition was very pleasant as we went close to the coast, our Genoese boatmen having a very becoming bashfulness as to meeting the corsairs at sea. 8 years later, Philip Francis has a very different experience. Embarked at Venice on board a Roman trading vessel bound to Ancona, passed the night in a hogsty, which the captain called his cabin, on a mattress in the utmost misery, the vessel full of goods and stinking passengers. Calms or contrary winds all night, continuance of misery. Godfrey eating, Francis spewing. He was then deterred from going overland to Naples by a route that avoided Rome. Upon inquiry, we found that the roads were impracticable, without posts or inns, and the people to the last degree brutal and barbarous. So we took the high road to Rome. Few tourists toured the southern Adriatic or the matching coast of Italy. The problems of travel help explain why Fernand Braudel, the great French historian of the 16th century Mediterranean, referred to distance as the first enemy and news as a luxury commodity, both long-standing issues. Rulers and ministers frequently complained that diplomats exceeded or otherwise misunderstood instructions. But it was difficult to provide orders that would comprehend all eventualities, or alternatively, to respond adequately to the pace of developments, including those caused by diplomatic negotiations and military moves. The slow and uncertain nature of communications ensured that considerable discretion had to be left to envoys if negotiations were to advance speedily. Special couriers could speed messages by land and sea, so that in the 16th century a message from Constantinople to Venice, sent on from the Venetian colony of Corfu by galley, could take 20 days. Communications, however, were not only slow by modern standards, they were also frequently uncertain, such that information could only be confirmed by waiting for subsequent messages. Moreover, uncertainty about the speed, indeed arrival, of messages ensured that they could be sent by separate routes simultaneously, notably from Constantinople to Paris via Marseille, the long sea route, and via the Adriatic, a shorter sea route, and Venice, and via Budapest, a route entirely by land. In 1731, in peacetime, the first route could take 39 days or more. 2 years later, when war with Austria broke out, Louis Sauveur, Marquis of Villeneuve, France's talented envoy in Constantinople from 1728 to 1741, preferred to send his mail to Paris, across the Adriatic to Ancona in the neutral Papal States, a short crossing, rather than along the Adriatic to neutral Venice, a route that increased the risk of interception by Austrian ships from Trieste. On the Constantinople-Paris route in 1787, during a period of peace, reports by the French envoy on the 25th of April and 26th of April, the second by sea, arrived on the 20th of May and the 3rd of July, respectively. Those of the 11th, 15th, 16th, the 25th of January, the 10th, the 23rd of February, the 10th, the 17th and 24th of March, the 10th and 25th of May and 9th of June, 1787, arrived on the 11th of February, the 6th of April, the 29th of March, the 26th of February, the 11th of March, the 25th of March, the 8th of April, the 31st of May, the 24th of April, the 9th of June, 23rd of June and 7th of July, respectively. In 1755, due to contrary winds, the new French envoy had taken 49 days to sail from Marseille to Constantinople. Such were the pressures that affected life and connections in the Mediterranean before the transformations to travel in the 19th century that were brought by steam, both steamships and railways. A very different view of the sea can be seen in Monaco's Clifftop Oceanographic Museum, where the display of species includes many Mediterranean ones. This serves as a reminder of the wonderful variety of that sea. To capture this variety, however, it is necessary also to look at its cultural resonances. Large ships at sea can be seen in the background of the Triptych of the Virgin of Montserrat, painted probably in 1470 to 1475 for Francesco della Chiesa, a merchant from Aquiterme in the present-day Italian region of Piedmont. He had settled in Valencia, where the work was painted and where the Virgin of Montserrat, venerated in a Catalan abbey, was called upon to watch over those involved in maritime trade. The painter Bartolomé de Cárdenas, about 1440 to about 1501, also produced stained glass window designs for the Merchants' Exchange building in Barcelona, but it is the somewhat elusive ships in the triptych, with their suggestion of voyages beyond, that capture the memory. Chapter 2. Antiquity, from the origins to 30 BCE. The Odyssey. Odysseus's fame as a traveller across the Mediterranean on his 10-year return from the already lengthy siege of Troy, the subject of Homer's epic The Iliad, was the subject of the sequel, The Odyssey, the first Mediterranean travelogue, the earliest manuscript of which dates from the 10th century BCE. The joy and details of a successful voyage were mentioned. Flashing-eyed Athene sent them a favourable wind, a strong-blowing west wind that sang over the wine-dark sea. The mast of fir the crew raised and set in the hollow socket, and made it fast with forestays, and hauled up the white sail with twisted thongs of oxhide. So the wind filled the belly of the sail, and the dark wave sang loudly about the stern of the ship. On Calypso's island, Odysseus, in Latin Ulysses, the legendary king of Ithaca, builds a ship, cutting down 20 trees with a bronze-headed axe. He cunningly smoothed them all and trued them to the line. He bored all the pieces and fitted them to one another, and with pegs and mortisings he hammered it together. He set in place the decks, bolting them to the close-set ribs as he continued the work. And he finished the raft with long gunwales. In it he set a mast and a yardarm fitted to it, and furthermore made him a steering oar with which to steer. Then he fenced in the hull from stem to stern with willow withes to be a defence against the waves, and covered the bottom with brush. Homer offered details of navigation. The comrades of Telemachus, drawing near the shore, furled the sail and took down the mast quickly, and rowed the ship to her anchorage with their oars. Then they threw out the mooring stones and made fast the stern cables, and themselves disembarked upon the shore of the sea, and made ready their meal and mixed the sparkling wine. Yet there were also the justified terrors of the monster-harbouring sea. These forced those planning a voyage to consider their options carefully. Thus, for the Greeks on the return home from Troy, in Lesbos, as we were debating the long voyage, whether we should sail to seaward of rugged Chios toward the Isle of Psyria, keeping Chios itself upon our left, or landward of Chios, past windy Mimas, so we asked the god to show us a sign, and he showed it us, and bade us cleave through the midst of the sea to Euboea, that we might the soonest escape from misery. And a shrill wind sprang up to blow, and the ships ran swiftly over the fish-filled ways, and at night put into Geraistus. There, on the altar of Poseidon, we laid many thighs of bulls, thankful to have traversed the great sea. So far so good, but then for Menelaus's fleet on the route home to Sparta, Zeus planned for him a hateful path, and poured upon him the blasts of shrill winds, and the waves were swollen to huge size, like mountains. Then he split the fleet in two, bringing some ships to Crete. The ships, the waves, dashed to pieces against the reef. The five other dark-prowed ships, the wind and wave, brought to Egypt. The Odyssey repeatedly reiterates the hazards of maritime travel. These hazards were human as well as natural. There is a rocky isle in the midst of the sea, midway between Ithaca and rugged Samos, Asteris, of no great size, but in it is a harbour where ships may lie with an entrance on either side. There, in ambush, the Achaean waited for him. The strange people and beasts Odysseus encountered, including the lethargic lotus-eaters, the cannibalistic Laestrygonians, and the sirens, underline the strong fear of the unknown that was an important aspect of a culture in which so much over the horizon was a matter of rumour and supposition. The Strait of Messina between the eastern tip of Sicily and the western of Calabria in southern Italy was probably the source of the account of Scylla, featuring a six-headed monster. With each head she carries off a man, and Charybdis, a whirlpool wrecking ships. There is indeed a natural whirlpool in the strait, and the legend testified to the travails of the sea and the anxiety aroused by threats to navigation. Strabo later referred to a monstrous deep, into which the ships are easily drawn by the refluent current of the straits, and plunged prow foremost, along with a mighty eddying of the whirlpool, and when the ships are gulped down and broken to pieces. An ambitious but very costly project to build a bridge across the strait and thus replace the uncertainties of a reliance on ferries in order to reach Sicily was cancelled in 2006 and anew in 2013. The Isoli dei Ciclopi, the islands of the Cyclopes, northeast of Catania in Sicily, were supposedly the rocks thrown at Odysseus's escaping boats by Polyphemus, the one-eyed giant he had just blinded. The enchantress Circe was a very different threat. Odysseus also repeatedly faced the attacks of wind and wave, as with the winds in Aeolus's leather bag and the thunderstorm caused by Zeus. The great wave struck Odysseus from above, rushing upon him with terrible force, and spun his raft in a circle. Far from the raft he fell, and let fall the steering oar from his hand. His mast was broke in the middle by the fierce blast of tumultuous winds that came upon it, and far in the sea sail and yardarm fell. Being shipwrecked, there were also the problems of a hostile coast. The boom of the sea upon the reefs, for the great wave thundered against the dry land, belching upon it in terrible fashion, and all things were wrapped in the foam of the sea, for there were neither harbours where ships might ride, nor roadsteads, but projecting headlands and reefs and cliffs. Odysseus's journeys, and more generally the Greeks' war with Troy, long set major themes for Western culture, and notably in painting. Neoclassical works drew greatly on both, as in Donato Creti's Achilles dragging the body of Hector round the walls of Troy, and François-Pascal Gérard's Achilles mourning Patroclus. The vivid light from the rising sun in J.M.W. Turner's Ulysses Deriding Polyphemus, 1829, is absorbing. He visited Italy on a number of occasions from 1819 and was entranced by the Mediterranean's fusion of light and antiquity. Early man. The idea of early hominins originating in the Mediterranean region has been strengthened by analysis of the fragmentary 7.2 million-year-old primate Gricopithecus from Greece and Bulgaria. Recently discovered human-like footprints from Crete, analysed in the 2010s, also test the established narrative, as they are approximately 5.7 million years old. There has also been a dating of finds suggesting very early activity in northwest Africa, notably Ternifene man, Atlanthropus, the remains of which were discovered in Algeria in 1954. There was continuity between types of early man, both in terms of breeding and with reference to sites. Thus, in Gibraltar, the same cave systems were used by successive human species, both Neanderthals and early Homo sapiens. Evidence of the latter outside Africa has been found far earlier than previously thought, for example in Epidema Cave in Greece, about 210,000 years ago, and in Israel, about 90,000 to 125,000 years ago. Judging from surviving remains, there was much activity later. There are numerous Paleolithic and Neolithic sites around the Mediterranean. In particular, Neolithic funeral mounds can be seen across the Mediterranean, for example, on the island of Pantelleria. In addition, Neolithic pottery was produced using obsidian from Lipari. The impressive archaeological museum in Ancona, an Italian Adriatic port that deserves more attention than it receives, includes not only Neolithic flint daggers, but also the Venus of Frassassi, which was carved about 26,000 BCE. A barrier in the absence of boats, the early Mediterranean was also a source of protein to those who lived on its shores. Although most histories tend to emphasize land cultivation, early civilizations, not surprisingly, were often shore-based. Fish, both sea and river, and shellfish were very welcome, and the development of harpoons and bows and arrows helped in catching the former, as did the adaptation of boats to particular maritime environments. For example, fassonis, flat-bottomed, reed-built boats used to catch fish in the marshes and lagoons off the Sinis Peninsula in Sardinia. Similar boats were found in other locations, such as the Rhone Delta. Protein from fish did not require the long processing needed to digest raw vegetables and fruits. The salt that could be obtained was also very welcome, as were edible marine plants. Early settlements, for example Philokopi on the Aegean island of Milos, were often for fishing, in its case for tuna. Around the Mediterranean, the warmer climate after the end of the last ice age in around 10,000 BCE provided encouragement and opportunities for wildlife and its human hunters to move north. Rock paintings in Spanish caves show panthers, and those in northwest Africa depict elephants, giraffes, and rhinoceroses. It is very clear that the range of animal life in the period was very different to that of today. This was linked to differences in the vegetation, but also to human activity. The North African or Barbary lion stretched from Egypt to Morocco, only recently being wiped out. Many had been used for Roman gladiatorial games. The North African and Syrian elephants were probably subspecies of the African and Asian elephants, respectively. Both became extinct in classical times. Agriculture and trade. Subsequent to the retreat of the ice, the spread of agriculture was gradually seen across the region. Large seeded grains, such as emmet and einkorn, early forms of wheat, were domesticated by about 9,000 BCE in northern Syria. Their cultivation spread, and by about 7,000 BCE, farming as opposed to hunter-gathering had become the leading form of subsistence in southwest Asia. From there, farming spread, including into Egypt and, via Greece, southern Italy, and then to much of the Mediterranean by 5000 BCE. This spread was linked to population growth, the development of fixed settlements, for example with the Bonu Ihinu culture of Sardinia, and the growth of specialist elites, including craftsmen, warriors, priests, and aristocrats. Drawing on Plato, Strabo saw civilization as resting essentially on the shore. Plato conjectures that after the time of the floods, three kinds of civilization were formed. The first, that on the mountain tops, which was simple and wild, when men were in fear of the waters which still deeply covered the plains. The second, that on the foothills, where men were now gradually taking courage because the plains were beginning to be relieved of the waters, and the third, that in the plains. One might speak equally of a fourth and fifth, or even more, but last of all, that on the sea coast and in the islands, when men had been finally released from all such fear. For the greater or less courage they took in approaching the sea would indicate several different stages of civilization and manners. As society became more differentiated and surpluses were produced, so opportunities for trade increased. This trade helped produce networks that spanned the Mediterranean and linked it to other maritime centres. The wealth of some cities depended on trade rather than rulership. These included ports in the eastern Mediterranean, such as Byblos, founded in about 3100 BCE, as well as Beirut, Tyre and Sidon, all cities in modern Lebanon that were collectively referred to as Phoenicia. As longer distance commerce developed, so there were more cross-cultural interactions, including trade to ports linking the Mediterranean to eastern maritime centres. For example, Dilmu, or Bahrain, and Ras al Junais, Oman. Trade also benefited from government, which provided security, not least by easing transactions through the means of law, coinage, and the policing of markets. Discoveries from Bronze Age Greece. Excavations since 2015 on the Aegean islet of Daskalio have revealed what appears to be a pilgrimage site from about 2600 BCE. Evidence of metal workshops and building with marble from the nearby island of Naxos has been found, and the marble would have required numerous voyages. Egypt. The significance of the Mediterranean, as opposed to, say, the Baltic, was that major civilizations developed on or near its shores. The most prominent was Egypt. In contrast to the soil of much of North Africa, that of the Nile Valley, replenished by silt annually brought down by the river, was fertile, and the link between river and sea was good. Moreover, the centre of power in Egypt was close to the Mediterranean's porous intermediary, the Nile Delta. Narmer, the first pharaoh or ruler of Egypt, who unified the country in about 3100 BCE, founded the mud-brick-walled city of Memphis as his capital on the west bank of the Nile, south of the Delta, not far from modern Cairo. Egypt was a Nile power, expanding south into Nubia. It was also a Mediterranean one, with control west into Libya and north into the Near East, where there were bitter struggles in the 15th and 13th century BCE over what is now Syria and Israel. Bronze Age Greece. Very differently, there were civilizations without great territorial power in what is now called Greece. In the Bronze Age, around 2200 to about 800 BCE, a series of societies emerged, using bronze, a more effective material than copper, that traded widely in the Mediterranean, notably the Minoan civilization of Crete and the Mycenaean culture of the Greek mainland. Palace-based societies emerged on Crete in about 2000 BCE, and the legendary King Minos provided the name for the civilization. These societies were destroyed, possibly by a volcanic explosion in Santorini and subsequent tsunami on Crete, in about 1627 to 1600 BCE. The extensive ruins of the palace at Knossos are a testimony to the sophistication of this society and are the major tourist destination on Crete. There are other Minoan sites there accessible to tourists, including Gurnia and Malia. Santorini is a key Aegean site from this period, while Minoan pottery has been found in the Bronze Age village of Panaria in the Aeolian islands north of Sicily. Mycenae, an impressive palace fortress which dominated the main road in mainland Greece between the two great ports of Argos and Corinth, had already become prominent in about 1550 BCE. And as Minoan culture went into decline, it then apparently took over control of Crete and the Cyclades islands. Mycenae, with its lion gate and its atmospheric view from the ramparts, has become busier and is best seen off-season. It is approached by cruise tourists as an outing from the port of Nafplio, so also with the theatre of Epidaurus, an impressive sight that can be visited as opposed to just seen. Mycenaean Greece, a warrior society, is the basis for the story of the Iliad, the account by Homer of an expedition by the Greeks, in revenge for the abduction of Helen, to besiege the city of Troy near the Dardanelles in modern Turkey. Honour was the key spur in Homer, honour in the shape of relations between men as well as control over a woman. Although the gods played the leading role in the story, pushing to the fore those humans who could interpret their messages, nevertheless, humans, such as Achilles, made choices, including in response to divine injunctions, and took the consequences. Mycenaean civilization collapsed in about 1100 BCE, possibly as a result of invasion, part of a more widespread collapse that affected the eastern Mediterranean, including the Egyptian and Hittite empires. The collapse was probably triggered partly by obscure invaders, aggregated sometimes in a misleading fashion as the Sea Peoples, by internal rebellions, and by the resulting crises in international trade and political control. This collapse, and the absence of a recovery, may also be linked to environmental problems, notably drought, and the effect of the entry of iron weapons into the region, which marked the start of the Iron Age, around 1100 BCE. The link between Mycenaean Greece and the Greece that resisted Persia in 490 to 479 BCE is obscure. There were dark ages from about 1100 BCE until the 8th century BCE. Archaeological evidence for this period is limited. Nevertheless, the resumption of writing in the 8th century, as the Greeks adopted and adapted the Phoenician alphabet developed in about 1050 BCE, was linked to the rise of city-states in the Greek world, but also with the Etruscans in northern and central Italy and with the Phoenician cities. Phoenicia. City-states, centres of power and trade that dominated their hinterlands, had a significance that depended on their role as intermediaries with other societies. These networks varied with power politics, environmental shifts, such as harbours silting up, and changing trading routes. Cities were industrial sites, largely processing and/or producing goods for their inhabitants and the surrounding area. Some, however, were also major industrial centres with their goods exported more widely. Strabo noted of Tyre, a major Phoenician centre and the leading one from the 9th century, the great number of dye works makes the city unpleasant to live in, yet it makes the city rich. For all cities, trade was essential, and this explained the importance of safeguarding maritime links by force, negotiation, and propitiating the gods. The economy was embedded in social, political, and religious practices. Protection was important due to the prevalence of piracy. To the Greeks, the Phoenicians, who appear in several stories in the Odyssey, were abductors and slave traders, as well as skillful sailors and purveyors of high-quality artifacts. In the Homeric Hymn to Dionysus, which dates from probably the 6th century BCE, there is a story about what happened when Etruscan pirates seized Dionysus under the impression that he was a king's son. Ultimately, the most important Phoenician city was Carthage, which was founded near Tunis, supposedly in 814 BCE and allegedly by Dido. In the western and central Mediterranean, the Phoenician settlements were subsumed by those of Carthage. The Phoenicians sailed further, indeed beyond the Mediterranean into Atlantic waters, both south along the coast of North Africa, although it is unclear how far, and also past a major base at Gades or Cadiz, north towards Britain. Along their routes, the Phoenicians founded trading bases, or at least ports of call. In modern Algeria, there were Carthaginian posts in the bays of Annaba and Algiers, and on the island of Rashkun, as well as Carthaginian-influenced settlements, as at Tidis. Tunisian sites included not only Carthage, but also Altiburus and Utica. In Sardinia, there was Cagliari, Bitia, Nora, Montisirai, Sant'Antioco, and Taros. Pantelleria was colonized by the Phoenicians in the 7th century. Medina, long the fortified capital of Malta, is Phoenician in origin, as was Carteia near Gibraltar. The Phoenician presence across the Mediterranean was more widespread than often appreciated. It was also correspondingly more varied. This presence was a matter not only of trade, but also of a power that seemingly derived from an ability to appeal to gods, such as Shadrapa, the counterpart to Dionysius, the Greek god of fertility and seafaring. Seafaring temples, such as the sanctuary of Ras el Wadia on the Maltese island of Gozo, were designed to provide an aid to seafarers. There is no indication that the Phoenicians also used maps to assist their navigation, but they had considerable knowledge of the seas they sailed. At the same time as similarities and links, the extent to which there was an ethnic self-consciousness as Phoenicians has been questioned. Instead, it has been argued that the category was a Greek one, designed to provide cohesion to people who self-identified instead more commonly with reference to particular city-states and who lacked unity or a homogeneous religion or consistent religious practices, such as the child sacrifice employed in at least some locations. Textual evidence is certainly weak for the Phoenicians, and notably so from them themselves, as opposed to hostile comment. The same is true for many ancient Mediterranean societies, for example, the Illyrians in modern Croatia, the Etruscans in Tuscany, the Philistines in Israel and Gaza, and the Nuragic culture on Sardinia. On the other hand, archaeological evidence for the Phoenicians and others has become more plentiful since the 1980s. Archaeology will continue to fill in many historical and geographical blanks. Moreover, the further incorporation of archaeological knowledge, for example, of extensive early settlement in Malta and Sardinia, into general historical works will spread our understanding of early Mediterranean history. Persia and the Greeks. Egypt, the first great Mediterranean empire, had succumbed in 525 BCE to another that was much more far-flung, that of the Persian Achaemenids, which was founded by Cyrus the Great, ruled 559 to 530 BCE. Cyrus had advanced to the Mediterranean, conquering the Greek cities in Ionia on the eastern shores of the Aegean in 546 to 545 BCE. The besieged cities were surrounded with a rampart, an embankment was built up, and the cities were stormed. In 539 BCE, he conquered Phoenicia. In 525, Cambyses II successfully besieged Gaza and defeated Psamtik III of Egypt at Pelusium, near modern Port Said, before going on to besiege Memphis and annex Egypt. Cambyses benefited from the assistance of a Greek fleet under Polycrates of Samos. His fleet included triremes, galleys with three rows of oars, as opposed to the earlier penticonters, one row, and biremes, two, the latter of Phoenician origin. It is unclear whether triremes were originally Greek or Phoenician. Under Darius I, the Great, ruled 522 to 586 BCE, the empire expanded further, Darius conquered Thrace in 513 BCE and then gained control over the Greek cities on the northern shore of the Aegean and made Macedon a vassal in 492 BCE. Modern continents, in this case Europe, Asia, and Africa, did not determine political bodies and their boundaries in the past, and this was certainly so around the shores of the Mediterranean. The Persians also used their conquests of Phoenicia and Egypt to build up a formidable navy, which they deployed to become a major force in the Aegean. The Greek cities in Ionia rebelled in 499 BCE, only to be crushed in 494 BCE at the Battle of Lade, a naval battle off Miletus won by the Persian fleet. The rebellion ended the following year. Darius then decided to punish Athens and Eretria on the island of Euboea, which had provided support for the rebellion. In 490 BCE, a Persian amphibious force conquered the Cyclades Islands and then destroyed Eretria, before landing at Marathon on Attica. A rapid Athenian response, however, led to the defeat of this larger force, the battle becoming crucial to the Athenian sense of their special destiny, not one to accept failure as anything bar a stage to revenge. Darius planned a return match, but postponed it due to a revolt in Egypt in 486 BCE. Sparta and Corinth were key players in Greece, as from the 480s BCE was Athens, which benefited from substantial silver mines, the basis for building up a large fleet. The development of specialized warships reflected the profit to be made from attacking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.